Hello and welcome to Boardwars.eu, your bi-weekly podcast about Star Wars Imperial Assault, a miniature game by Fantasy Flight Games. I am your host, Stefan, and with me again is Herwig. Hi, Herwig.
Hi there, guys. Hi, Stefan.
And today we probably have the best show for you yet, because after the long episode number four, where we discussed most of the Star Wars celebrations, we will do a little bit of shorter episode today, and we'll mostly focus on actual board game stuff. Yeah, the first I wanted to clean up, our topics today are like, the topics are the same as in the previous weeks, but we mixed them up a bit, because we received feedback, constructive feedback of course, that we shouldn't stick around too long with a specific topic, especially the card reviews, because it's kind of boring to hear just me talk about the cards. Yeah. So what we'll do for this episode, we will mix up the card discussion with all the other topics, so it will be a mishmash of all topics. So, the first we have today is news and cleanup, and we are still looking for co-hosts. Ideally, I want to have three or four guys on the show in total, including me and Herwig, of course. So, we will look for one or two additional co-hosts, and if you have a time slot available on... Mostly we record on Thursday night, Central European time. If you have a time slot available, you can apply via mail to podcast@boardwars.eu. And if you play the game a lot, it will be, of course, a benefit. And if you don't play the game a lot, like me and Herwig probably the last 2 weeks, then you will also be welcome. So if you're interested in joining the show, just send us an email. And I also looked over our Facebook page and our podcast stats, of course, and our Facebook page is growing steadily, and we probably have a big spike of new people until the next and between now and the seventh episode, because we'll post some polls there, I think, and we have currently, I think, 38 Facebook likes, which is respectable, I think, for that we are only up for like 2 months or so.
Yeah.
And just over 50% of the listeners of the show are not from the US and Canada, which is also... I was aiming a little higher than that, actually, but it's okay. So we still love you guys over the pond. So also, you're of course not excluded from the raffle. And the raffle itself, I sent out all of the packages which we had winners for the first three episodes. So this was, I think it was Han, the IG-88, and the Rebel Saboteurs. And I already got feedback from one of the winners that the Han package already arrived. So the others should too, actually, somewhere around this time. And I successfully cleaned my backlog of packs I have to send out after I received them. And yes, of course. Then for our Facebook page, you really should join there, because Herwig made a good suggestion for the next episode. We will talk about our wish list for Gen Con, of course, and the game itself for the future developments. And if you have some wishes for the board game which we want to see discussed on the show, you can send them on the Facebook page, either via private message, or we will open up a post there, and you can post it in the comments if you have some wishes for the game. Also, I already started my list, and I know Herwig did too, but you of course can send in stuff, and we will credit you of course if you send in stuff, and we will use it on the show.
I think it's a good point for this little exercise, because probably they will announce a lot of stuff at Gen Con, and I think September or November is like the starting day for all the Force Awakens merchandise. I think they said September the 4th, something like that. There will be the starting point for the unveiling of all the, well, they start selling some and they're allowed to show the merchandise for The Force Awakens. So, in September we will see what Fantasy Flight has in store, will do with their movie license. So,
Yeah, maybe we even get the first saga expansion
yeah,
revealed.
maybe, yeah,
We'll
that's
see.
would make sense in a way.
That's already one of the ticket items I have on my list,
Yeah.
but we will see. So, and the second issue, you should join the Facebook page. Also, because from episode 7 on, we will probably talk about the missions in the game, like strategies, how to tackle each mission on each side, which specific places in the mission to exploit, what to take care of. And because I know some of the, especially on Hervik's side, his players will also use, listen to the podcast, so I will put up a poll if we should only talk about skirmish missions, or if we also should include single player campaign missions, not single player missions, but campaign missions. And when we discuss the campaign missions, if we should do them spoiler free, or if we should basically reveal all mechanics in the mission. I think it wouldn't be that much of a problem, but because we will not talk about more than one, maybe two missions per episode, I suggest we will talk about one. And so the if you start your campaign now, you should have enough time to complete the campaign before we talk about the mission. So this should only factor in for most of the listeners on the second playthrough for the campaign. But yeah, I will just open up a poll and you can vote if you want to have the missions discussed at all, and if they will be discussed, if we should do it spoiler free. So also we had one email coming in from one of our listeners, from Matt, and he clarified last time we discussed the Fantasy Flight news with the new ally and villain packs, the Wave 2 packs. And is it Wave 2? No, it's Wave 3, right? The Wave 2 packs are there for the Twin Shadows expansion, and after that, in the fall, we get the Wave 3 packs with the Wookiees, the hired guns, and the Stormtroopers. And we discussed one of the cards in there, which is improvised weapons, and there is this picture of a green guy throwing a table, and we weren't quite sure what kind of alien race this is, and Matt clarified that this is actually bearable, whatever this is, because I can't remember it being anywhere in the movies or so. So it's probably something only appearing in the extended universe so far. And but thanks not for thanks Matt for sending that in. And of course, if other people send in trivia tidbits, we greatly appreciate this. So that's. I think that's all for our cleanup for today, and we will hop straight away to our first card discussion, which will be about Mac Ashkari this time. We also will talk about Diala, Pasil, and of course the technological superiority deck. But we will first talk about the sniper, and this time Herrick will start. Reading about the sniper, I think. You have the hero sheet, right? I forgot if you have the hero sheet or the XP cards.
I have the XP cards. Hero sheet
Okay, so I
is.
will talk about the hero sheet and
Yeah,
you will then
perfect.
take over the XP cards. So, our first rebel player we will discuss today is the sniper, or actually, he's called Bold Renegade on the card. And it's Mac Ashkari. He has two abilities, which are the first is Ambush. For one strain, use when you declare an attack targeting a figure that does not have line of sight to you. This attack gains Pierce 2. This sounds a bit tricky to trigger, but if you read further the second ability he has, which is Covert, hostile figures 4 or more spaces away from you do not have line of sight to you. You do not block line of sight for those figures, which first means they have to. They have to come close to you to actually target you, and if they can't target you, you also can use your ambush ability to actually to gain Pierce 2 on your attack, which is needed because his first weapon is the long blaster, which attacks with two blue dice and has surge abilities, surge plus 1 damage and surge pierce 1. This is the pierce 1, of course, stacks with the pierce 2 from ambush. And since the blue dice, they don't roll that high on damage, you really need the pierce 1 and pierce 2 abilities to actually deal damage with mech, at least in the beginning. Later on you can get much better weapons. So mech also has 10 health points, 5 endurance, which is quite a lot for him actually. 4 speed, a white defense die, and like medium strength and perception checks, and a high engineering check. And of course he loses, on the wounded side, he loses his covert ability, which is quite a problem if you play him. So mech is a sniper type, and his XP cards I think reflect this. And Herrick, do you want to take over and tell us what the first two 1 XP cards are?
Yeah, so his first 1 XP card is Supply Network. Exhaust this card during your activation to test awareness. If you pass, reveal the top card of the supply deck and place it on the top or the bottom of the deck. Or you can, as a action, deplete this card to draw one card from the supply deck. It must be my birthday.
I like this card.
It's really good if you get it early in the campaign, because having a supply card at the end of a mission is worth 50 credits, so not bad.
Yeah, that's true, but if you use the special action and exhaust the card, you don't get the actual crate, you only get a card. And the card isn't worth 50 credits.
Ah, you give only back the crates?
Yes, you only get the 50 credits for the crate.
I thought only for the cards.
No, this would be...
money making.
Basically 53 credits for mech during all of the campaign.
Could be game
least,
breaking.
Yeah, you can. It wouldn't be game. I think it wouldn't be game breaking, but it would be certainly a bit much stronger than it is now. And nevertheless, I think drawing a card from the supply deck for one action, without having to actually pick up a crate, can be worth it. Most, like I said it last time, I think most of the supply cards are definitely usable during the missions, and they can help you out quite a lot. And even if you don't get the 50 credits when you use the card with this action, you still get the actual item to use.
Yeah,
and this could be a game changer during the mission.
Yeah, well, having a healing kit or something at the right moment is
that's
quite important.
In my first campaign, most of the times when I tried to, my players actually recruited Luke Skywalker, and they took him on like 4 missions or so, and they almost all the time managed to actually prohibit me from defeating him by just applying medkits to him like all the time. So I was shooting Luke, and he was always gaining health back, and with his regeneration ability, he also gained health back, so it was very hard for me to kill him. And with his ability to make all the attacks the rebels had to be able to reroll one dice, it was really strong for them. So they basically made sure I couldn't kill him, and without being able to kill him, their attacks were really strong. So.
Yeah.
Okay, do you want to read the next card?
Yeah, disengage. Spend one strain. Exhaust this card when a hostile figure enters a space within 3 spaces of you to gain 3 movement points. The Imperial Military Police couldn't take me alive, and neither will you.
Yeah, it fits right in with the theme of Mac, I think.
Yeah.
So you can, it's basically an interrupt to make sure that at least if you have a strain available, and it's the first time this round, to make sure that an Imperial figure cannot come close to you to actually target you.
Yeah.
And I think one of my players took this in the first campaign, and it was very annoying for me, especially if you play melee character figures like the Royal Guards or the Royal Guard Champion or Vader. This is really annoying because you can't get close to him to actually deal damage
Yeah,
to
you
him.
have to bait him in with one melee activation, so he exhausts this ability, and then you finally can attack him. So.
Yes, this was really it was aggravating, and nevertheless, this time around in this campaign, the player playing Mac didn't actually take this abilities, but saved up his experience points for one of the four experience cards, and I think he paid the price for this because I managed to wound him, I think, three or four times in the first five missions or so. So it's really, I think it's a very good first XP card. But yeah, the one strain. Mac has five endurance, so the one strain, it's
Yeah.
not that much of a price to pay, I think. So if you play Mac, I think you should take disengage.
Yeah, makes sense, I think. Just to be, it's a good way to escape your dreadful Imperial player,
Yeah, and of course you not only can use it to escape, you just gain three movement points. You can go anywhere you like. So you can also use these three movement points to make headway towards an objective.
yeah. Yeah.
So this is, I think it's good. So onto the two XP cards.
Yeah,
You wanna read them?
yep.
The first one?
Target acquired. Spend one strain. Exhaust this card before declaring an attack. During this attack, figures do not block your line of sight. Apply plus two accuracy to the attack result. Ha! I bet even a Jedi couldn't make that shot. Yeah, it's not too
This
bad.
is, oh, I think for one strain again, also one card. This is one card one of my players used last campaign, and it's okay. I think
It's okay,
Mac
yeah.
has with the long blaster. Mac rolls for at least four. Is it? Yeah, it's at least four range, and with this you can guarantee a range of at least six, which is longer than most hallways in the on the tiles.
Yeah.
So, maybe it's a bit overkill to give two accuracy to this shot because most of the time you don't need it. But if you do need it, also if you then later buy weapons that don't have two blue dice but maybe have just one blue dice, you can still manage to stay farther back and deliver shots from farther back at least once a round. And with the two accuracy and being able to actually hit them.
Yeah.
So, it's. I think the disengage card is better,
Yeah.
but yeah.
Yeah, it depends on your style of play. If you want to hide your sniper a lot and not try to come in the first line, depending on your other players. If you have the Wookie in your party and the Jedi, then those two will try to get into close combat anyway, so you could hide behind them, yeah. So if you're playing with two of the have more some of the close combat brawlers in your rebel team, so then it makes more sense to use it. If you have a group with a lot of guys who are also shooting, then it doesn't make that much of a sense, maybe.
Yeah, you should take the next 2 XP card, I think.
Yeah. So the next card is Cheshwandi Training. Apply plus two health to your hero. Never bad. Exhaust this card after a hostile figure within three spaces resolves an attack. You become focused. Yeah, it's nice. I think it's the better of the two because more or less getting a free focus.
This campaign, at least in my campaign, the player playing Mac, like I said, he saved up for the 4 XP
Yeah.
ability, and he didn't get either of the 2 XP cards, and neither did he get the 1 XP cards. And I think the 2 health would have been very good for him because if you find yourself in the front line, you are a very squishy target. You
Yeah.
just have 10 health. 10 health.
Ten
And
is really
white
nothing.
die. It's you can bank on rolling dodges all the time, but
Yeah, but it's
that's
a one in six chance, so.
Yeah. And you can't reroll your dodges like the Jedi can. And this is, I think, getting 2 health and also the second ability, getting a focus of a figure within 3 spaces, resource and attack. If you position yourself right, you can trigger this, maybe not every round, but you can basically trigger it like twice or three times a mission. And 2 or 3 times a mission, gaining a free focus is very, very good
Yeah.
because you're deal that much, much more damage then.
Yeah.
So I haven't seen this card in action, but I think it's actually very strong, and I'll probably take it over target acquired.
Yeah. Well, it's thinking about that, most of the missions on the Imperial side, the rebels lose when the Imperium has wounded all the heroes. It makes sense to pick skill cards that give you a higher wound threshold, so you can withstand more punishment. Because the missions I played so far, it was always very close. Like in the last round, giving like the last two or three wounds to a blaster damage to a hero to finally wound him. So two extra wounds doesn't sound that much, but it can really make the difference in a round, especially in a game that's like time plays such a big factor. So yeah.
Yeah, I think also just 1D training is less valuable if you play with less figures. Like if you only play with 2 rebel figures and you have already the legendary card, which gives you, I think,
Yeah, five or
five
so,
or
yeah.
whatever it gives, the 2 health doesn't factor in that much. So you maybe can use target acquired. But then again, if you play with less rebel figures, you don't need the line of sight ignore for this card anyway.
Yeah.
So both of the 2 XP cards are probably more valuable the more figures you actually play in your rebel group, and both of them are less valuable the less figures you
Yeah.
have. At least that's how I see it. I don't know. Like I only played with 1 campaign with 3 rebel figures and the second campaign now we have 4 rebel figures. And I didn't find it that hard for Mac to actually find targets to shoot at, despite him being farther back and probably being line of sight blocked. So he didn't really need target acquired. So I don't know. Maybe
Yeah.
it's still just 1D training is better.
Yeah. Okay, then on to the 3 XP cards. The first one is Expertise. Pay 1 strain, exhaust this card during your activation after you interact. Perform 1 additional action during this activation. I rather not waste any time when there are troopers I could be putting holes in.
This is a strange card.
Yeah, it's for 3 XP. It's, well, it's, I think, how, yeah, I don't know how often you really interact, so, but yeah, more or less you can get crates for free-ish.
Yeah, not only crates, but
You can pick up a
I
crate,
think.
pay 1 strain, and then shoot still in the round, so
Yeah,
yeah.
of course. You can pick up a crate and shoot 2 times.
Yeah.
Because you still have your second action
Yeah,
also. But
sorry,
I think.
in my head, the character already moved there in the first action. I didn't
Yes,
say it
yes.
before. Sorry.
But I think what this really is good for, in my opinion, is to open doors. Because if you're an open. Mo in many missions, not in most, but in many missions, if rebels open doors, something is triggered on the Imperial side, and most of the time, some units deploy anywhere near this door. So if you can move to a door, open it, and then still shoot, this normally helps you to deal with the additional threat that spawned
Yeah.
by actually opening the door. Also, if you can strain, but with strain, I don't know if it works with strain, but if you can start your round near the door, open it, and then shoot twice, maybe even with one of the 4 XP cards we will later see, you can probably get rid of one or even two figures that
Yeah.
spawned right then and there. And since all the figures spawned, usually spawn in a ready state, so they are not exhausted, so they can still act this round. They pose a much greater threat because they are in your immediate
Yeah.
in vicinity, and they still can act, and you are standing exposed. So it's I think expertise, it's overlooked, and I haven't seen it in action yet. But if I would play mech, I would for sure get it even over the 2 XP cards.
Yeah.
Because you usually, and also mech has a very good engineering test, so most of the, or I think most of the doors you have to open with a test, you open with an engineering test, so you are one of the figures that is good for this anyway, so you want to be this guy opening the door, so it would be good for you to actually being able to deliver a shot afterwards.
Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah.
I don't know, like I still haven't seen it in action, but I think it's good.
I think it's good for exactly that moment you described, opening the door and then getting 2 hits in on the freshly spawned enemy figures. That would be actually quite nice, yeah.
Yeah, and of course you can also use it to actually, like Herrick said, to open crates and then shoot your way out of the
Yeah.
situations. Or if you open a crate and pick up a frag grenade, or what's it called, a thermal detonator,
Yeah.
actually, you can also throw it immediately after, even if you moved to the crate first. So this also maybe that helps you, but I can't see this be that valuable actually. Oh, you can, if it's a med kit, you can rest and then apply the med kit. This also can help, especially with the supply network card, where you can take a look at the next card you draw. I don't know, maybe it's good.
Yeah.
I would like to see that action,
Yeah.
but I haven't.
So the second 3 point XP card is Execute. After you resolve an attack, if the target figure was defeated, recover one strain. And as a additional skill, exhaust one strain. Exhaust this pay one strain. Exhaust this card when you use Ambush. Remove all white die from the target's defense pool. Yeah.
Yeah, it's okay. I think I don't know if the player I have now has actually bought this card. I can't remember. I seen it in action either last campaign or this campaign. And the strain recover after you defeat a target, it's certainly nice, but unless you manage to get the really nice blaster in the tier 3 with two red die and the base 6 accuracy, I think you have a hard time killing stuff without the 4 XP cards, and this is already 3 XP. So it's I don't know, I'd rather take expertise, I think.
Yeah.
It certainly helps you kill stuff, but I don't know. It seems rather weak for 3 XP.
Yeah, it's just, I don't know, it's.
Removing just the white dice also, I don't know. You remove the dodge chance, but that's basically it, because the white dice, aside from it, when you use it on Nexus where you have the surge cancel to block ability, aside from that, the white dice can't roll that high anyway, and you have your this only works when you use ambush anyway. And ambush gives you 2 pierce, so you basically pierce through the defense of the white dice anyway,
Yeah.
and you only negate the chance to that the target can dodge your attack. This seems awfully, the one strain seems awfully much to pay for this, but yeah, I don't think it's good.
Yeah. I think I'm with you there. Just you recovering one strain. Yeah, I think it's not worth it for that. I think that saving up for one of the 4 XP cards is worth more if you already own 3 XP. Okay, so on to the 4 XP cards. The first one, No Escape. pay 2 strain, exhaust this card after you resolved an attack. If the target figure was not defeated, you become focused. Then perform 1 additional attack targeting the same figure. And stay down. Yeah, not bad.
I think it's one of the best cards you can get from him. The 2 strain is certainly much, but
being able
to do an additional attack
and be focused
is always good. Of course, you also become focused, which deals that much more damage.
It's really good in the late game just to be able to take down some of the heavy hitters the Imperial player could throw at you.
Mm-hmm. It's certainly really aggravating to watch as an Imperial player to have a unit survive just the first shot, the first 2 shots, and then on the second shot he exhausts his cards, takes 2 strain again, and absolutely wrecks your last 2 hit points or 1 hit point.
Yeah.
Or so. Yeah, I think no questions asked. You should get this card in basically any campaign. I can see it not being useful. It's certainly useful multiple times during any mission.
Yeah.
So just get it.
I don't know if
it's probably his best card.
Would be racing for it at the beginning, saving up and get it immediately. I don't know. Get it, but I don't know if I would like to save up my 4 XP.
Yeah, that's a tough question to answer, because especially the 1 XP cards and or just 1D training, they are still good, and saving up means you have maybe 3 or 4 missions where you don't get any other XP cards. And no escape is really good, and I think saving up the 4 XP might be valuable, but I have to play more to be sure. It's certainly either it's the best card or one of the best 2 cards, I think. So it could be worth saving up your 4 XP for it.
Yeah.
It's that strong. In my opinion, it's that strong.
Yeah, you could be right, yeah. But yeah,
my player in the second campaign I have did that exactly that, and most of his usefulness now comes from this card.
Yeah.
And I only can defend with this because I'm playing subversive tactics and loading him up with strain. Not every round, but between the rounds, and try to make it so he can't use ambush 2, which would be absolutely devastating. So
yeah. Okay, and the last skill card for our character is Decoy. Deplete this card when an attack targeting you is declared. The attack misses. After the attack is resolved, you may interrupt to place your figure in any empty space within 3 spaces. Then you become focused and may perform an attack. Yeah.
Since it's deplete, it gives you 1 additional attack per mission, and it can save your ass. But my player used this in the first campaign, and it's certainly on the Imperial side, it's hard to watch.
Yeah.
Because you want to maybe it's a very good card if your group works really well together and you can keep Mac the last unwounded guy. And if he's the last unwounded guy and the Imperial player wants to focus his attention on him, you can use this card to basically negate 1 attack and maybe even kill the figure who was attacking. So it's very good, but you need good team play for it.
Yeah.
Because if you are focused and if you're standing too much in front on the front line, then Decoy, you might use Decoy too often and too early, and then you are basically defenseless. So
yeah.
I don't know. You could try building mech defensively with just 1D training and Decoy, and maybe what's it called, disengage. Try this, and you can basically, you are becoming a very slippery target, because you can run away, you can decoy, you have more health, and it's okay. But I think he should deal damage.
Yeah.
And for dealing damage, you should actually use cards that help you deal damage, because You see it on the first weapon he gets. He just has two blue dice, and it doesn't deal that much damage. And cards that can help you deal damage maybe takes the pressure off the credit pool to actually get you a better weapon. So I don't know. It depends on the group, and if you can, if the group plays perfect, maybe decoy is better than no escape, but I doubt it. So I'd say no escape is still better, and it's the 4 XP card you should actually get. And if you have XP over, maybe get decoy, but I
Yeah,
don't know. The other
again,
cards are good too.
I think it's really depends on the setup of your rebel commando team, and if you already have another damage dealer, then maybe it's a good choice that you become like the slippery one. And if you are like one of the damage dealers in the group, then of course you should go for all the skill cards that deal more damage. So I think it really depends on what kind of group you have.
Yeah, it's not only what other characters you have, but also what skills they are getting.
Yeah.
So if you already have a damage dealer, maybe it's actually better to be a delivery target. I don't know. And you, what I think is you should prioritize one of the two. If you get disengage and or decoy, and or just wanted training, you should stick to this tree or this branch in your XP cards.
Yeah.
And make use of this. Maybe I think it's worth to actually focus on it, not to then mix and match with damage abilities, because you should then try to actually draw fire and make this fire basically useless.
Yeah.
So you take the heat of the other characters. I don't know. Maybe that's what I would play, but I probably would play him as a damage dealer.
Yeah, but I think what you said really makes sense, so yeah.
Okay, I think that's all of the Muk Eshkari XP cards. Yeah, we have all eight, I think.
I think if
And
I would play Rebel, I probably would play with him. He seemed for me like the most fun type.
yeah, he's certainly the most entertaining to watch, because with his cards, either he is dancing around the battlefield, similar to Jhin,
Yeah.
or with the other cards, he's dealing damage that you can't even imagine. It's crazy to look at it in the on the board.
And he's a Boten,
But
so.
yeah, he's a Bothan. His brethren died to bring us the plans of the Death Star.
Okay.
Okay, so this is the card discussion for Mac Ashkari, and we will continue on with our second topic, which is campaign and skirmish play experiences. So, did you play the in the last 2 weeks, or didn't you manage to?
Sadly,
Because
because we played more sessions of our. Well, my main problem is I'm playing with the same guys. I'm playing my Star Wars role playing game. It's like the same group. We play Imperial Assault, and the last 2 weeks we squeezed in sessions of the role playing game, and couldn't find the time for playing Imperial Assault, so I couldn't continue the
okay.
campaign. But we continued
Yeah.
our role playing campaign, so.
Yeah, that's also good.
Yeah, it was great fun. So we now really got the hang of the system, and we played a little Indiana Jones like mission where we were searching for lost treasure in Hutt space, so it was quite fun, yeah.
How long do you did you actually play, or how long do you play the role-playing game altogether?
Gosh, I think
When did you start?
it must be now half a year, maybe even
Oh,
already a
it's just after a
year. I
year.
don't
Yeah.
know really. I can't really.
Okay, so about a year,
I
maybe.
think a year about. It depends. We had some big breaks between some sessions, and now we're managing it to play it more regularly. So that's really important too, if you want to get, know the rules of a new system. And the problem we had in the first session when we played like once, and then 2 months later or a month later, then you really forgot.
Everyone forgot how it
Yeah.
works.
And
I know.
now we're getting the hang of it, which yeah also means we now know how to get the best out of our skill trees. So Some of our characters are becoming really real monsters, real killing machines.
Okay. Yeah. So let's just hope that you don't fall into this trap with Imperial Assault 2, that you can't play it for many weeks and the players actually forget how to play the game.
Now,
Because.
I'm hoping forward to find time on one of the upcoming holidays, so we could play like our Saturday afternoon until evening, so we could get in 3 missions or 2 missions at least. So,
Yeah, that's better, yeah. We have like two holidays coming up now, so
yeah.
it's maybe you find the time. So I myself did only play one session with my campaign group. I didn't really try to find a skirmish game for the IA command skirmish league, but at least I looked at the board where they posted the matches and looked at some of the stuff there. But for my offline group, we played the mission, what's it called? The Spice Job, where the rebels could recruit Chewbacca. And I also put up pictures of both missions I played on the Facebook page if someone is interested. I also tend to write some stuff alongside the. Oh, that's my cell phone. I also tend to write stuff alongside the pictures, so it's like a little narrative about the mission. And during the spice job, you get the Wookie as a free ally, and the rebels need to secure 6 spice barrels. Each of the spice barrels you need to either use the Wookie, so Chewbacca, with to pick them up, or a hero can also pick them up, but they need to do a strength test. And also, this of course costs one action of your activation. And since they also need to open a door, they also need to find the key card for the door. So they need to three of the starting figures of the Imperial player have tokens under their plates, under their bases. So they are neutral. They are gray neutral mission tokens. And on the flip side, they have a color. And at the start of the mission, the Imperial player is instructed to choose 2 red and 1 yellow, or 2 yellow and 1 red. I don't know. Of course, doesn't matter. One of them is a different color than the other two, and this is the key card. And heroes can defeat this figure, then the token drops, and one rebel can go to this token and interact with it to reveal it and claim it. And if it's the key card, this character can now open doors. And 4 of the spice barrels are locked away behind doors, so you need this key card to complete the mission. And between picking up the key card, opening the door, and picking up all spice barrels, you already need eight activation, not 8 activations, but 8 actions to complete the mission objective. And my players, and you only have 5 rounds to complete this. And my players, they didn't actually focus on the mission, but tried to chase down one of the Imperial figures. So. I won the mission. We won the mission, of course, in the fourth round, because they couldn't pick up the last remaining token, which was the key card, and get to the door and open the door in 1 round. So it was basically a victory for me until then, and they just lost because they were lazy with their activations and with they didn't really focus on the mission. So. I mean, we didn't play bad. We tried to hide away the figure we knew had the key card,
Yeah.
and to shield it with what's it called, Royal Guard troops. But I think they could have won the mission. They didn't use Chewie effectively, and they were too hesitant. They stormed my units, and then after storming them, they used the rest of their movement points to back away again, which I think was their main problem. They just didn't have enough movement points to get through the map, actually defeat the figure with the key card, pick up the key card, and open the door. So it was a bit anticlimactic, I must say. But in the end, we did win, and the rebels failed to recruit Chewbacca. which was nice for us because we got free influence
Ooh,
additional to the
sweet.
free we already had.
Wow,
Yeah.
that's not bad. So your rival group hasn't won a single mission yet. Is that true?
No, they did one mission. They did win one
Okay.
mission, which was generous than donations. And this is one of the missions you there isn't a clear win condition because it's a race for credits or influence. You basically have to the rebels have to storm a complex, and in this complex you have three terminals, and you have 8 rounds to complete the mission, and after which the mission is over. And each round that the rebels control one of the terminals, they get one token, which represents, I think, what's it called? It's, I think, 100 credits. So they get 300 credits per round for 4 rounds. Is it
Wow.
300? It should be more. Actually, it should be more. I don't know. Maybe it's 400. I can't remember. And then they also did pick up crates, and they ended up. We couldn't. And the Imperial player, the goal of the Imperial player is to deactivate the terminals, and for this you have to get rid of all adjacent rebel figures, and you need one Imperial figure adjacent to it, and then you can at the end of the round you can flip it and it's deactivated or something like this, and you can basically prevent it from giving more credits to the rebels, but we didn't manage to prevent even one of the of the terminals, so they basically got all the money they could during this mission, and they ended up with like 2,450 credits just from this mission, which is quite a lot.
Wow.
And they went on a shopping spree after this,
Yeah.
but in the end it didn't help them because they did lose all of the other missions until now.
Yeah, not bad.
But it's also generous donations. It's a fun mission. And our plan actually was to save up Fred and then storm the complex with an AT-ST and do a grand finale and wound all of them. But it didn't actually work out.
I think for my next campaign, I also will do like a two-player Imperial team because I think it sounds much more fun than being alone there and making all these
Yeah, that's
decisions.
it's basically it also I think it's better for the rebels because you start discussing strategy not with yourself where they can't hear you, but with another player. And since the rebels discussed a strategy, I always found this a bit strange that the rebels need to discuss strategy across the table
Yeah.
and the Imperial player can hear this, and he also has the increased knowledge of knowing what events are going to happen when,
Yeah.
and how to distribute his threat, and how to
Yeah,
spawn units when and where.
that's very true. I always like when my group starts to planning like 5 turns or 3 turns ahead, I'm always like,
Yeah.
guys, anything can happen. I don't know when,
I
where,
know.
but don't make so long big plans because they're like in
Yeah.
the next activation they're like planning 10 activations through, yeah, and I'm
Yeah,
always like,
that's
this
bad.
plan won't work, and they're like, oh, you're only saying it because you want to win. No, I'm saying this because there could be some events there or not. It doesn't make a sense to plan more than like 3 activations or 5 activations ahead.
I think as a rebel group, you shouldn't plan more than the current round. If you can plan the current round and if you can actually execute your plan, then it's already a win for you because that means the Imperial player couldn't do anything against your plans, which is all you can hope for. And you should plan your moves, or not only your moves, all of your activations to make progress towards your actual mission goal.
Yeah.
This is what really bit my rebel players in the ass during the spice job mission. It's really they just didn't watch the clock. They thought they had enough time, but then they noticed at the start of the last round they couldn't actually muster the activations too, because you can only open the doors with the hero picking up the key card. They couldn't strain to the key card, pick it up and move to the door, and also open the door, because all this ne at least needs 3 interactions, and you only have two actions this round. It was bad. They were really discouraged after that.
Yeah, it's.
So you should plan your activations, but not so far in advance. You only need to plan your round,
Yeah.
I think. At least that is what I do with my Imperial troops. I only try to make the best of the current round, and after that, I will try to adjust my plan based on what's happened during the round.
Yeah.
But yeah, let's see. And we also we did a double session in which we tacked on another mission, and because we are the Imperial team, so we not only did we have six threat then, but we also had the agenda card where we draw one additional card during each Imperial upgrade stage, so we don't get four cards, we get five
Ooh.
cards to choose from. And we managed to draw Impounded, which is, I think, one of the most expensive forced missions, which costs four influence. And we also drew one of the two influence cards that I don't know what's it actually. Yeah, it's not restorative supplies, it's something like this, where you can use it once a mission and basically heal an Imperial figure for two red die. You roll two red die and basically heal one of your Imperial figures for the amount of damage you rolled on the two die, so maximum
Yeah.
six damage. And this is, I think, it will be good in the later stages where we have General Wise and Vader coming into the battlefield, which they should survive. And if we can heal them at the end of a round, it will be good. So we bought Impounded and this card. And Impounded is a forced mission, which was a first for us, because in the first campaign I couldn't get any threat to save my life. And so I never really got to buy a forced mission. And Impounded is I think it's my new favorite mission for now, because it's very thematic and it's a story about the Rebel team being stranded on Tatooine or some other planet, I don't know. And the shuttle they came with and the pilot of the shuttle, both were like, the shuttle is in docking clamps and the Imperials are inspecting it or whatever, and the pilot is thrown as food in
Yeah.
front of two Nexai, and they start to pound on him, and you have to rescue him and also release the docking clamps, and you have to carry him to the shuttle, and all this in five rounds, and it was a massacre for the rebels. We pounded them into the ground. It was basically over
Cool.
in 3 rounds, where we, after 3 rounds, we wounded all of the Imperial, all of the rebel characters. And I think they played a bit wrong. It's a really hard mission for the rebels. I have to say that it's probably one of the hardest missions for the rebels so far I have seen. But we had a very good plan, I think, where we made use of both Nexu figures from the first round on, which I think isn't intended for you to do, but we managed to figure out how to do it, and so that they were wailing on the rebel figure, on the rebel heroes, and they used cleave and bleed and whatever they have. So it was a disaster for the rebels. And as reward, we got one of the coolest cards I've seen yet. It's a reward card for the Imperial player, and what's it called? I forgot. Something with special operations, I think. Yes. And it's an attachment which gives, you can only attach it to a leader, and I think the only leaders the Imperial player has so far is the Imperial officer and Vader. I don't know if the Royal Guard champion is also a leader, I forgot. But
I think
anyway,
yes.
we can't earn him anyway, so we can use him anyway. Yeah, doesn't matter. Of course, you can attach it to any leader, and it gives this leader a special action where you can use the special action every round, once a round, for to add
Ooh.
one to your threat. So if you slap it on a regular Imperial officer, and the Imperial officer is just giving his order as a move action to another figure, and the second action you would only like move one space or so, you can instead use this action now to gain one threat. And if you do this twice, the Imperial officer already paid for itself, which is very good, I think. So this basically elevates our threat level
Jesus.
from 5 to 6 now. Like we had, I think, no,
Wow.
from 4 to 5, yeah. So we are on threat level 4 now, and we can't be on threat level 5 basically now, which is very good because at threat level 5 you can deploy either one in elite imperial officer, or you can deploy a elite imperial droid. It's very so it's basically it's
Yeah.
boosting you one tier up. And this is, I think it's very good. We will see in the next mission, which is another side mission, if this actually helps us or if it's turned out to be inconsequential. But I think it's a good card. I think it. I don't know if it's if it turns out to be very good. I think the mission to get it should be made a bit harder for the Imperial player.
Well, it's hard enough to get the first mission into the game, so.
Yeah, it's only. I say it only, but it's. If you have the option to save for influence and play the impounded mission, I would really recommend it. After what I saw, I would really recommend to do so because I can't on from the Imperials from the Rebel side, I can't see how to win this mission. I mean, it's certainly possible, but for this dude, the Imperial player has to win.
Yeah, I think all the forced missions are really hard for the rebels to win, but I think that's the spirit more or less.
Yeah, after all, the Imperial player is paying some influence to get it, but maybe then the reward shouldn't be that this strong because if you would have played it even one or two missions earlier, it would be that much stronger because from threat level 3 to threat level 4, it's a much bigger step than from 4 to 5 and from 5 to 6 and from 6 to 7. So the attachment it's getting weaker throughout the campaign, but I don't know. Maybe that's their. That maybe that was their rationale to that the Imperial player
Yeah.
wouldn't be able to get it that early in the campaign. I don't know. So it's a good it's the mission itself. I think it's very, from the mechanics and how it works. It's massively cool. I want to play it again, but with maybe with because this week two of my Rebel players couldn't attend, so we're playing two players on the Imperial side and two players on the Rebel side, and the Rebel players they were one of them were is new. This is his first campaign, and the other one, it's not a he's not a bad player.
Yeah.
But he's certainly weaker than one of the two other players that were missing this time. So they were basically. That's also, I think, why they lost the spice job mission. So
So how many missions do you have left in your second campaign?
we have one side mission, then we have one story. So one side, one story, one side, and two story. Five missions.
Okay.
Yeah. The next mission is what's it's. Target of opportunity, I think, where the rebels can win the not the rebel troopers, but the other ones, the ones
Saboteurs.
we gave the saboteurs, of course, yeah, the ones we gave away for the raffle. Okay, so it's the mission to win the saboteurs, and I think it's a quick mission. It's also it doesn't have a time limit actually, but
Ooh.
it's a very small map, and either the rebels can free the saboteurs and use them to open the door, or they will just die in front of the door because they need to open the door and get to a terminal. And the door has 8 health and 5 block innate. So you need to deal more than 5 damage to actually damage the door. Which is hard if you have problems getting pierce. But if you have the rebel saboteurs, I think they throw. They attack with one red and one yellow die, and they can trigger surge abilities twice, and they have one of the surge abilities is Pierce 2. And if they attack a door in this mission, they get one surge automatically, like for free. So they get Pierce 2. You can choose to use the surge for another surge ability on the Saboteur card, but you will use it for, of course, for Pierce 2. And so If you roll one search, you have Pierce 4 already, which makes them the ideal tool to open this door. So you can win this mission without freeing the saboteurs, but it's very hard. So I don't know what my players will do. We'll see. Actually next Tuesday, I think we'll play. I don't know. So in a few days. And then we have, of course, another story mission, then another side mission, and then the two last story missions. So five missions in total, and we'll be finished with our second campaign. I think right in time. Maybe we can fit in another campaign before Twin Shadows comes out. I don't know. Because I want to
Yeah.
try something else. Maybe I'll play Rebel next time. I don't know. Not sure.
I think we will see Twin Shadows. It's
And
not
maybe
yet
it's.
on the boat on the upcoming page at FFG,
You
so
sure?
it's not yet on the boat, so it's at the printer still, so
Oh, it's at the printer, okay.
In the moment it's on the boat, we know it's 5 weeks ish.
Okay, then we'll probably have, let's see,
But
expansions. Yeah, it's still at the printer.
I think it's end of June, June-ish will be a good time for it because maybe they have some copies at Origin. It's a game show in the US, and maybe they have some copies there. Fly-ins, a couple of them, but
And also, I think you have to tack on 2 or 3 weeks for it to actually get to Europe so I can buy it.
yeah, that really depends if they already did a shipping to Europe and America at the same time or not, or
Oh,
if they're
yeah, of
shipping
course, yeah.
from America to Europe. It's that this is always different, so it's very hard to say. Sometimes, like with Imperial Assault, they shipped the copies first to Europe and they were sitting there until you could buy it early at Essen, I think. So the 100 copies were sold early at Essen because it was like 1 month earlier in Europe.
And you don't plan to go to Essen this year, right?
This year not, maybe next year, yeah. It would be
What
interesting, yeah.
were you last year?
No, but
Okay, no.
it's one of the things I want to do someday, yeah.
I also either I'll take the plunge and go to Gen Con next year or to Essen next year, because this year I looked at prices for hotels in Essen and it's already I don't want to pay that much just to go to Essen,
Yeah.
so yeah. If I can,
Well,
can get a hotel for free, like from one, maybe I can apply with Heidelberger to do
demoing, yeah.
some demoing. Then maybe I'll go this year, but I don't think so. So
Yeah. Star Wars Celebration is next year in London, so
in London, ooh,
that
next
could be,
year.
yeah.
Is it also in April next year?
I think they already set the date for next year in London, so
Yeah, so the hotels are already booked.
yeah.
So, okay, yeah, maybe I'll go there. But London is, I was in London 2 years ago, 1 year ago. I don't know anymore. And so I want to go to Essen or to the US. We'll see. So this is campaign and skirmish play experiences. This time, of course, we just had campaign experiences. And after this, we will go on to rebirth you our last hero, which is our Jedi. And do you have any of the cards on your desk, or did you find none of them?
I have the hero sheet with
You have
me.
the hero sheet, the weapon too, or just the hero sheet?
And the weapon.
Oh, okay. Then please take us
Well.
through the hero sheet of Diala Pasiel.
So, our dear Jedi starts with two skills. The first skill is the following. Precision strike costs two strain. Use when you declare an attack with a melee weapon. Choose and remove one die from the target's defense pool, limit to be once per activation. And the second skill is for one strain, foresight. Use while defending to re-roll one of your defense dice.
This
And
is
so this is
my
a
players.
Yeah.
My players thought, because of the second ability, that this is actually a tank.
Yeah.
But it turns out she isn't.
Yeah, it's just, yeah, you need luck f to re-roll your white die so you can dodge the second time. Yeah.
Yeah. Can you read the weapon so we
Yeah.
can so I
So,
can
she starts with the Plasteel staff. It's a staff, it has reach, and for one critical, for one surge, you can buy a stun, or the second one is one blast damage is added. And it has a green and a yellow die.
Yeah, and of course it's not one blast damage, it's just plus one damage to
One
the
plus
attack.
one damage, sorry, yeah.
It's not blast, yeah.
Plus one damage to the attack, yeah. And she starts with 12 health, has 5 endurance, a speed of 4, and a white defense die. And she's from her skills, she's very good at awareness and not so good at might, and mechanically she only has one blue die, so yeah.
I think she's interesting. I think I misled my players when I talked about her, because I said because of her foresight skill, you can reroll your white defense die, and which it turns out to be a one in three chance to roll any weight for one strain, which is quite good actually. They
Yep.
had some evades during the mission, but she also has some XP cards that are based around tanking and standing in the middle of it, in the middle of the action and taking the heat. But since I saw how easy she can go down, I think I have to revise my not my strategy, but my how I view her, because I think she's not sturdy enough to be a tank. She's not sturdy, not as sturdy as the Wookie, certainly not. So I think you shouldn't go the tank route with her. I see that it doesn't actually work that good, but okay. So of course she also has XP cards, and since Herwig couldn't find his XP cards, I will
They're
do the
all
XP
across
cards
the
for
room,
myself.
and
They're all across the room. Herwig had a little furniture problem in his room last few days, I think. So, the first 2 1 XP cards are Force Throw, which is you pay 2 strain for exhaust this card during your activation to choose another small figure within 3 spaces and test sight. If you pass, push that figure 3 spaces, then if the figure is hostile, it suffers 1 damage. This is actually, I linked a Board Game Geek thread. I will link it also in the show notes. A Board Game Geek thread where someone calculated the odds of making this sight test. And if Diala is healthy and she's focused, there is a 49.4 percent chance to succeed as this test. And if she's just healthy, there's an 88.9 chance to succeed. And if she's wounded and what is it called? Wounded and focused, there's an 86.1 chance. And if she's just wounded, there's a 72.2 chance to make this test. So you pay 2 strain, and if you're not wounded, you basically succeed. You basically fail 1 in 10 times. So it's not that much of a gamble. You basically succeed every time. And for this, you can move one figure for 3 spaces, and you can also choose allies, and of course ally figures and other rebel figures. So you can take one of your companions and push him around the board, 3 spaces. And this 3 spaces is actually important, because you ignore any
Yeah,
movement
so
penalties.
it's not 3 movement points, it's really 3 spaces. It's always important, yeah.
Yes, so you can push them over this blue stuff, and I think, I don't know, but can you move spaces over reds, impassable terrain
I
or
don't
blocking
no,
terrain.
I don't think so, because you never can draw a line through it. And I think if you, even if you throw, you need to be able to have a line of sight, and you can't throw it over the red
Okay.
corner without the line of sight, so.
Okay. But at least you can throw them over the red dashed line.
Yeah, that's of
The just
course,
that
yeah.
the blocking is it called blocking terrain? Yeah, it's I think it's called blocking terrain. No,
Well,
it's
with that tact, yeah.
impassable terrain, that's it.
It's the classic Wookie throw, many people called it. Just pick up the Wookie
Yeah.
and throw it into the combat.
Into the enemies and then Wookie can cleave and blah. This is
It's basically
my players
what
didn't.
Colossus always does with Wolverine in the comics, just making the Wolverine cannonball and throwing Wolverine into the combat.
I think it's a very good ability, and my players didn't take it for whatever reason.
Yeah, me, my
And
neither. I don't know why.
I take it. This is the first card I take. It's just one XP, and I take it after aftermath for sure. Even if I have 2 XP, because the 2 XP cards, they are a bit, they are good. But I think Force Throw is so versatile, and can you help to get to certain, what's it called? To certain objectives that much
Yeah.
faster. It's crazy. Also, you can manipulate the enemy figures. So if one figure is too far away, if the enemy figure is too far away for your melee allies, you can pull them here, pull them towards you, or you can push them away from you or whatever you want. So it's I think it's really good. I would this is one of the best cards for her, I
Yeah,
think.
I would say so too, yeah.
So it's certainly better than the second 1 XP card, which is Force Adept. Pay one strain to use while you or a friendly figure is performing an attack or attribute test. That figure may reroll one die. And the second ability on the card is exhaust this card when you perform a strength or engineering test. Add one blue die to your dice pool. No. The engineering test for Diala, you already told us it's just one
Yeah.
blue die. And the strength test is blue and green, so it's a bit better. But the blue dice, they don't have that much surges on. So the second ability of this card, it's not good. You don't want to use this anyway. So I think the second part of the card is basically worthless. And the first part is you pay one strain to reroll one die. It's yeah, the problem with Diala is you have to take care of your endurance, because she has 5 endurance, but you have so many strain abilities, and the strain abilities are unusually expensive that you probably can't even spare one strain for this.
Yeah.
So Force Adept, I don't know. It seems weak to me. It's for certain it's much weaker than Force Throw.
Yeah.
Force Throw is much more versatile, and even if you have to pay one strain more, it's much better, I think.
There are many more moments you can use this, so.
Yes. At least I think it's much more flexible. Okay, so on to the 2 XP cards, which the first of which is Defensive Stance. When you use Foresight, apply one block to your defense results. And the second ability on the same card is, after an attack targeting you is resolved, if you suffered no damage, you become focused. This in combination with Foresight is good, because it's not even good because when you use Foresight, you have a 1 in 3 chance to roll a dodge, and if you roll this dodge, you also become focused. But not also because do you become focused if you roll a dodge. You also become focused if the Imperial player is attacking with a ranged attack and misses outright. So Defensive Stance, it seems it's also very I think it's very good.
Yeah.
It's one of the cards that seems to suggest to you that you should go the tanking route, because you it says to when you use Foresight, apply +1 block to your defense results. So it seems like it's telling you to draw fire, but I'd say it's also valuable if you don't draw fire, if you're just getting attacked normally, not like from every figure, but just normally. So I don't know. I think it's better than the second 2 XP card, but you shouldn't deceive yourself that this makes her a tank or so. So the second 2 XP card is Battle Meditation. Use when you rest during your activation. Test side. If you pass, choose yourself or a friendly figure. That figure becomes focused. It's the same test which is on Force Throw, so that it has the same probability. You usually make this test, and you don't actually do anything for this card. You don't have to pay any strain or so. And if you play against what's it called, the deck I'm playing now, the Subversive Tactics deck, it says. Yeah. So yeah, if you play against Subversive Tactics, then Battle Meditation, I think it's a must-have. Because you are resting unusually often, because with Subversive Tactics you accrue strain at a higher rate, so you need to rest more often. And this allows you to become focused after resting. And focus is always good. So also you can not only choose yourself. If you are for whatever reason already focused, you can give this to another hero, and it's not wasted. So you usually rest once or twice a mission, which results to once or twice getting free focus per mission. You only lose this ability for when you fail the actual sight or what's it called, perception check or whatever it is. So this is it's I think it's actually better than defensive stance, and it doesn't give you the illusion that you can now tank stuff you shouldn't really tank. So take Battle Meditation, I think. Of course, my players, they took after I told them foresight is dodge and whatever, they took defensive stance, and I think they paid for it. So on to the 3 XP cards. The first of which is Art of Movement, which reads apply +1 speed to your hero. And the second one is you ignore additional movement point costs when entering difficult terrain or spaces containing hostile figures. I will read the second card too, because I think it's an interesting choice. The second is Snap Kick. Exhaust this card after you resolve an attack with a melee weapon to choose one hostile figure adjacent to you and roll one green die. That figure suffers damage equal to the damage results on this die. Art of Movement certainly helps you achieve objectives. So if your team decides that you should do the objective stuff, then Art of Movement is a surefire way to get there. Because not only can you move one space farther with your movement action, you also ignore basically every blue area. And there are some missions where you have to go through blue areas, and these usually cost you 2 additional movement points, and you just negate this. And Snap Kick, I don't know. It's basically a free attack for no strain. It's not a full attack, because it's just one green die, but you deal additional damage. Oops. You deal additional damage, and you can do it every round without having to use strain for it. I think it's okay, since most of the time you will use melee attacks. I think she's the least valuable hero with a ranged attack. I think Garkon is much more viable with a ranged attack, but she, I think you should basically use melee weapons all the time, so this triggers at least once a round, and it's good. But I think if your team decides that you should do objectives, take Art of Movement instead. Okay, on to the last two cards, which is the first is Dancing Weapons. It's a special ability, a special action, of course, and pay 1 strain to perform a ranged attack using a melee weapon. Add 1 blue die to the attack pool and gain search for 2 accuracy and +1 damage. So this is like a lightsaber throw, just with everything, not just lightsabers. And there was a clarification we had. I don't know if we did it in the show, but there's a clarification about if you can use cleave with it. And the ruling was that you can use cleave with it. This works since you cleave with a range attack, then basically everything inside is cleavable. So if your melee weapon has cleave on it, you use dancing weapon and you hit and actually deal damage. You can apply the cleave damage to every other enemy figure you can draw line of sight to. You don't need to have any range to it because you technically could attack it. You don't need to reach it. So any line of sight character you can apply the range, which can be really nice, but this is certainly better if you have less rebel heroes than you have when you have more rebel heroes, because rebel heroes tend to block your line of sight and whatever. So dancing weapon is good, but I think the next one, the last card I'll introduce for Diala, is Way of the Salak. It's a special action for 2 strain. For each hostile figure adjacent to you, perform one attack with a melee weapon targeting that figure. And this is like a brawl or so. You stand in the middle of let's say a group of stormtroopers, and you can technically reach all of them if they are adjacent to you, of course. And then you can attack all of them once, which is, of course, you distribute your damage over all of them, but you can trigger cleave on every attack if you have it on the weapon. So if you have a weapon with cleave and attack 3 times and trigger cleave three times, it's madness. So you can claw through enemies like madness, and this is also what my player uses. But the problem is, since it's costing 2 strain, and I already unload strain on them every turn, he didn't get he used it once, but only for 2 targets. And it's certainly viable there, because you can move up to 2 targets, use what's it called? Use Way of the Salak, and still attack 2 times. You just can't attack 2 times the same target, but you also attack 2 times, so it's similar to actually attacking 2 times. So I think it's the better of the 2 4 XP cards, but I don't know. If you're playing against subversive tactics, maybe using battle meditation and art of movement is much more viable than Way of Salak. I can't say for now, but I get the feeling that this is this way.
I think one thing we should talk about is like the elephant in the room. We have a Jedi without the lightsaber, and you get the lightsaber only if
Yeah,
you
with the
finish a
special
character
mission.
mission.
Yes, that's. I think the rationale is, she isn't actually a Jedi, so she's force sensitive, and she never had Jedi training from what I understand. The problem with the lightsaber stuff is her hero sheet actually pictures her holding a lightsaber.
The
So
figure also.
maybe they should have gone with the plastic stuff on her hero sheet. That would have made more sense then, because everyone's calling her a Jedi now, and everyone's implying that she has this all of the Jedi abilities. I'd say we. My feeling is that we will get another rebel hero down the line in some expansion pack, which will be a real Jedi, and there will be some overlap, but I think the real Jedi abilities will be a bit stronger, and he will be overall stronger, and he or she will probably replace Diala. We will see, but that's the feeling I get, because
I think she will be focused on something different, because from her abilities, she is not much. She's focused in like you said, filling some fields, but she's not really a tank. But I think we will see like a more tanky Jedi character. We will see maybe a little bit more one with more movement. And comparing it to the role-playing game, It's like she's like the force sensitive exile. It's just like one Jedi class. There is also the force power emergent or something like that. Exactly, like some character is just realizing he has powers of the force, so he could be probably the next one, or some old Padawan or something, like an old Padawan who was able to escape Order 66, like Kanan in Rebels, which continues in June.
Rebels 2,
Yep.
the second season. I
Yeah,
thought we had to
continues in
wait a
June.
year. Okay, that's
No,
good.
it's already continues in it starts second season starts I think 15th or 20th of June with like the two part or three part Darth Vader episode, so
Wow, cool. Yeah, about Diala. I think also calling her Haunted Exile was a problem with this because it implies that she is, she already had Jedi training when she,
yeah.
when her abilities, I don't know, they do reflect her being force sensitive and being able to use the force, but she's not a Jedi. That's
Yeah.
all. I think FFG should have made this more clear,
Yeah,
either with a hero sheet or through
there
some other
isn't
stuff.
much fluff text in the campaign book or the rules or something. That's surprised me a little bit. Like
Yeah,
there's hardly
that's
any fluff on the
yes.
heroes and so on, so
This is also what I have on my wish list.
yeah.
Okay, so that's it for our Jedi non-Jedi character. And next up we have community stuff. And this week, I think you wanted to talk about, or we wanted to talk about upcoming heroes and or villains, through the RGB,
Yeah.
RPG art, because the Star Wars RPG is already out for 2.5 years now, something like
About
that,
that,
and they have already many books printed and many artworks in the books. And some of the artworks of Imperial Assault is already lifted, not lifted, of course, but is already reused from the RPG books.
yeah.
So Herwig, in the last 2 weeks, did look for art that is in the rule books of the RPG game, and that might come popping up
Yeah,
in
of
Imperial Assault.
course, now it's a little bit complicated that we both, I sent the pictures to you, we both are talking now about artwork that you guys can't
Talking
know.
about the picture, can you
Yeah.
resend them? Because I'm on a different PC now, so
Ah, just give me a
I forgot to save
second.
them on the cloud.
Where
Yeah.
are you? Here you are. Yeah, I sent you like the first pictures we can talk about. It's some of the artwork we already have seen on some of the command cards. So the first one we can talk about are these heavy rebel troopers. You see them on one of the command cards. It's a nice artwork. It's used several times in the Age of Rebellion books. So the Age of the Rebellion books are all the books that focus on the rebels and their struggling fight against the Imperium. So it's the second, they had like three parts. One is just like all the scum and villainy of the Outer Rim and Edge of the Empire. You can play like as Han Solo, all these characters basically from the Mos Eisley Cantina. Yeah. Second series was Edge of the Rebellion, which is like you join the rebellion, you have your duties, you fight for the rebellion. In any way or form you like, you can fight it more politically with gaining influence on worlds or be like a commando or a spy. And the third set is now being released. It's for the Jedi players. So you play various different classes of forgotten or
Force
hidden
users.
Jedi Force users in the universe and have specific missions where you go. Well, you can do anything anyhow, but they're like some adventures where you try to find old hidden temples of the Jedi and trying to fulfill your training there. So, but back to the artwork. It's an artwork. It's they look similar to the old rebel troopers in their nicely vests from the beginning of A New Hope, but these are a little bit more in combat gear, I would say. They have the big helmets again, but they're also wearing the combat rifle. I think it's the same rifle the commando troopers use on Endor. So I think there could be some heavy troopers, heavy rebel troopers, or something like that.
And two of them, do they have visors, or is this
yeah, it's
a
full
cloth helmet?
helmet. It's
what
a full helmet. Yeah.
Is this in the RPG?
You have different.
This,
yeah, there's some different armor, so it could be one of the. I think carpet, or then you have the enclosed armor. So yeah, it could be one of the other armor sets. Yeah. Because I think the normal rebel troopers would be qualified for wearing heavy clothing or armored clothing, so they look more than mean business. So.
Okay, and of course, if the listeners want to look at it, I will link them in the show notes. So we'll host them on the website and just click on the links, and you'll also see what we are talking about here.
Yeah. The future of technology.
Maybe they really will be released as a heavy rebel trooper group, because we already see that there are heavy stormtroopers incoming, and maybe they will basically mirror what the heavy stormtroopers are, maybe with not heavy weapons, but yeah, we will see.
We could at this point talk about the stormtrooper artworks. I think the most important thing, which is a takeaway from the Stormtrooper artwork, is we all know we will see some Scout Troopers at some point. So, if we have a set of the next bigger campaign set, which will be playing on a ice planet or anything like that, or probably
yeah,
will play on Hoth, we will see the Snowtroopers, just because they're just such an iconic look, so they can't not use it. Which is all, another stormtrooper which is also on this artwork is the Dark Trooper. And the Dark Trooper.
It's a big one.
Yeah, it's a project. It's not really, it's more or less a battle droid. The Dark Trooper.
So is it a full on mech, or is it a robot controlled by a human inside?
It's a full on droid.
So it's a, okay, it's a droid.
And I think this would be an interesting campaign setting, because there are some stories in Expanded Universe where the rebels destroy like the Dark Trooper facilities, and it would make a great campaign. And also you would have a big, I think he could be like a 2x2 base, or maybe only a 1x2, but...
Yeah, maybe he can have, maybe he's still a small figure, but he's... he's more resilient or something.
Yeah.
Like
well,
he has two blocks or three blocks.
Yeah, and some version of the Dark Troopers are throughout Forces Unleashed. You see variants of them. So I think the Dark Trooper project also, it would fit in this commando raiding secret facility setting that we have now in Imperial Assault, because the Trooper facilities are always like the secret facilities that have been ambushed and destroyed by the rebels, so the number of the actual Dark Troopers is very limited to the Imperium. So this would be actually very interesting, and I think we will see them, because they already are using the artwork in the book, so...
Mm-hmm. Yes. The Dark Trooper would especially be interesting to see in the campaign.
Yeah, well...
Also for the skirmish,
yeah.
Because it's maybe some hybrid between a stormtrooper and a droid. We'll see.
Then we go on to some of the rebel artwork. We have here artwork of a rebel spy. And I think we will see maybe as a player character, or maybe as a ally character, but this artwork there's like featured in throughout the books in several different versions of it, so yeah.
Maybe it's the problem is that Imperial Assault is still a miniatures game, so we probably won't see allies that will be there for just one mission, or just like a set of two or three missions that are not that are important for story purposes or so.
Yeah.
Because if they want to include that, a spy or so would be the ideal choice, because he could help the players clear some objectives, or get them through some doors, or clear some terminals. And because he doesn't look like a frontline fighter.
Yeah.
So it would be maybe an interesting idea to craft a mission where you have to escort this character to an objective and then protect him from enemy fire for like one round or two rounds or so. This would be, I think this would be the ideal use for this artwork or for this style of character.
Or break him
Because
out of
of
a prison after he got
but breaking
caught.
off of prison, of course, yes.
And stuff like that, yeah.
Maybe even in sequence, you have to break him out and then escort him on a mission and then doing some other stuff with him. So could be a small mini campaign or whatever. But I think in the beginning, since we will see figures for all of this, all figures will have a real deployment card and will be viable for fighting. I am actually quite interesting how this will work for the two droids we'll get during the what's it called? During the Twin Shadows expansion.
R2-D2 and C-3PO, we'll see, yeah. The next one is this rebel commando-ish looking guy, girl, sorry.
Yeah, it's a
And
girl, yes.
yeah, I think probably we'll see her because it's the same quality of artwork which was used for Rebel Saboteur, so. And she looks like a close combat version, like a close combat assassin or something like that, commando, so. I don't
Maybe
know.
similar to Mech, just that she'll be in close combat and not in ranged attacks.
Yeah, could be that she's like the counterbalance to him, yeah. Being the close combat assassin and he's like the sniping assassin. Yeah, I don't know if she will be as a he used to be as a hero figure or just as a ally, so I don't know that we.
Nah, I don't know. I can see her as a hero. She's the artwork already. It has much character, and I think you could basically. It would be easy for the team to construct a set of mechanics that reflect this character. So because she's holding a blaster and a knife, so maybe
Yeah, a
she can
vibro
even
knife,
dual
a
wield.
big, yeah.
So similar to what Jin does with two pistols, maybe, I don't know, that would be an idea, so.
Next one is again a human trooper, human commando, and her artwork is I think she's in the beginner set, and her artwork of her is heavily in throughout all the Age of Rebellion books. And
Oh.
she's like a human commando-ish camouflage trooper, so with a Beatles haircut, so yeah, maybe we see her.
Yeah. It's interesting because I from what the artwork, she's sitting on a speeder, right? And she's eating some fruit.
Maybe even
Yeah.
the camouflage is even maybe she's an alien, it's her skin anyway, so
Oh,
maybe.
okay.
Maybe she's some
Yeah.
weird alien, I don't know.
Maybe she's some weird alien, yes.
But yeah.
But since we already have the with Fenn, we have already have a commander type. Maybe she's some. Maybe she can be something different.
Yeah, scout or something else, yeah.
Scout, yes. Yeah, it's interesting.
And just because I like them and we probably will see them as like a Mon Calamari technician and yeah, I think it's without big of a stretch that we will see
Yeah,
some Mon
this is,
Calamari character, and it's
yeah,
just the
this
artwork
would
of a very
probably
cool
be, yes.
technician, so
He will come to the game for sure. I can guarantee you that.
Yeah, so
This
some version of a Mon
either as an
Calamari.
ally or as a hero,
I
but I can
think,
see him be a
yeah,
hero, no problem.
and this was just like a cool Mon Calamari artwork. There are several really cool. Most of them are some officers in the Age of Rebellion books, and this is one of the artworks. I think it's from the. It's actually from the Aces book, from the Imperial Rebel Aces, as for the
Yes.
pilot class. There are also books with more developed this career path. And he's like, I think, the Tinkerer class. So he's a pilot and always tinkering on his own ship and make it more, building in new gadgets and new toys.
Yes. I can see it. I think it will. He will be a good hero, I think. Maybe something along the line that he can use different weapons and use different or construct new search abilities during the mission or something like this.
Yeah, that would be interesting, huh?
This
Of course, there are a ton of artwork of characters in the rebel jumpsuits, in the pilot suits. Yeah, I don't know if we, man, they are really iconic. The rebel flight suits. I think one of those thing which have a high recognition value. So I don't know if we will see them or not. If we see a rebel character, pilot character in the game, I
Yeah,
don't
I can,
know.
of course, as a hero, of course. I
Yeah.
mean, the Mon Calamari might even be a pilot,
Yeah.
and the one that the thing I said with the mechanic that he can construct new search abilities. Maybe this is the defining trait of pilots then in the game. This might actually so, I would ha wouldn't have that much of a problem fighting with a pilot,
Yeah.
because we saw pilots fighting already, so.
Yeah,
In
I think
the
that's
movies.
we'll see them in some combination just because this pilot jumpsuit is so iconic for Star Wars, so
Yeah, I think we will get some hero or at least an ally wearing the jumpsuit eventually.
yeah. So yeah, that's the artwork I choose for this time. It's just like a little snippet, but I
I think
think
some of the stuff will that the first artwork, it's already on one
yeah.
of the command cards, and it's I don't know, maybe it's a, is it reinforcements or something like this? I can't remember. I think it's the one you get with the general vice
Yeah, I
pack.
think we will probably see this because they can use them before. We, at a later point, we will have a set which will focus on the time period of Return of the Jedi, and then we will have all the Jungle Commando, all the Endor Commando troops we can think of. But until then, I think we will have some other Rebel troopers.
Yeah, that's it's good. And now, of course, I will link all of the artwork on the in the show notes so the listeners
Yeah,
can watch
or
in
yeah, maybe,
during
yeah.
our discussion. Okay, then the other thing we wanted to talk about are alternate tokens. Herwig dug up a link to
Yeah.
litco.net. I will also link this in the show notes, of course. They are manufacturing. What is is it
Yeah, I think
acryl
it's
or
acryl.
what is it?
Litco is doing a lot of alternative marker and add-on for various board games, also role enhancements for role-playing games and so on. And because Imperial Assault is a huge hit and has been selling like crazy, they also started, of course, started making acrylic markers for this game system. And of course, I will for future episodes, I will try to keep track and will try to always report on new stuff in the communities because I have several board game sites bookmarked which produce like inlays, alternative tokens, and so on. And we've already seen with X-Wing, there were a lot of companies which produced nicer looking tokens, cooler flight path thingies, flight rulers and
Yeah,
so on.
the ruler stuff for the. Yeah, I will probably order some of these,
Yeah, I
but
really
not
like
maybe
some of
for our
them. I
third
really
campaign,
like
but.
the strain tokens and the plus damage tokens. I really like those two.
I will, because what I found during our last session is that if you that the pile of tokens you inevitably have on the desk, if you split it up in two and put it into two opposite corners across the actual playing mission
Yeah.
field, and do the same with the with dice, and that's this the because I now have three sets of dice because I the one from the base set and two additional ones. I can divide it up also into groups or two stashes, and also put them into opposite corners of the mission, and so each player can reach both
Yeah.
tokens and dice basically from where he sits. So No reaching over the table and no knocking over figures and so. So this is additional stuff on the table. Initially, I thought it would crowd the table and everything would get more messy. But if you figure out that if you make small amounts of stuff available to all players, it's actually much better then. So getting additional tokens will help with this.
Well, some of these tokens are also, if you want to, you can replace them. So they are a little bit nicer looking, and this, if you like it more, it's always a, there's some companies which are doing wood tokens, laser cut wood. If
But
you,
probably more expensive, I think.
And most of them use some kind of acrylic or something like that because I think it's easy and cheap. And it depends if you like more the feel of a hard plastic token or the cardboard token you have now. So that's actually how you like it. I think cooler also to have replacement tokens for like objective markers and entry markers. So you have little rebel troopers. It's like now the rebel trooper the signal are the for the entry point you can have a nice token and so on. So there
Also the initiative token. Is the initiative token 3D?
yeah
Is this do a
yeah
because it's the same that you have on
it's
the
a round token and like two acrylic lightsabers standing up. Yeah, so
Yeah,
it's a little bit,
that actually looks cool.
it looks a little bit cooler than the normal one, but I think they're just like the first of many companies who will do stuff like this. Litco is just, I think, the ones who have their process faster and more streamlined than other companies. But I think depending on the success, because more or less all the little companies are doing something for Star Wars X-Wing. If they see the opportunity, we will have other companies doing stuff. There's one small company who is doing 3D prints of like the doors and the containers and terminals.
That would also be cool. Do you have the link?
Yeah, I have the link there. At the moment, they're just overwhelmed with the order, so they more or less shut down
Oh,
the Etsy shop.
I want some too. 3D
Yeah,
doors.
well, the
And
doors and open and closed doors you can still buy at the moment. The terminals and all the other stuff is at the moment not available. But they posted on
ah, crap.
Facebook that the end of May or something like that they are taking orders again because they're now
Okay,
shipping like the
yeah.
first patch and the stuff looks decent. It wasn't, I think, not that expensive. I think a whole set was for €30 or something, which is okay considering you get 8 boxes, 8 terminals, and a couple of doors. So,
That's more than enough.
but yeah, I think some of the Litco stuff you can have a look.
Have you already ordered or bought some acrylic tokens for Descent, and are they lighter than wood, or are they heavier?
They have a little bit of a weight to it. I haven't. I know people who bought some other stuff from Litco for other board games. They're doing like plastic viruses for pandemic. They have some stuff, a lot of stuff for Arkham horror games. So you can have for Arkham various Arkham horror games in the Fantasy Flight line. They have some stuff for you. So yeah, I know.
Yeah, because I think the tokens would improve a bit if they would have more weight to
Yeah.
them. Because the cardboard tokens
They have light.
they have some weight, but they still feel very
Yeah, I
flimsy,
think
I
many
think.
people like this with the Netrunner sets because there are se several companies on Etsy, Tim Convenient, Litco, gosh, who else? I think Custom Meeples in Spain. A lot of different companies are doing replacement tokens for Netrunner. And many people said they really liked it. Now the stuff has a little bit of weight to it and it's not so flimsy. It really, you know.
Yes, this is what I would have wanted from alternate tokens to for them to be a bit more sturdy feeling and more
Yeah,
heavy and so.
but yeah, we—that's probably just the beginning, and we will have the link to the Litco stuff.
Yeah, and we will update the stuff if new sites pop
Yeah.
up offering Imperial Assault
Which probably will be
tokens or
several of
other
them, yeah.
add-ons, whatever. Also, when we are on the topic of tokens and add-ons, do you sleeve your cards?
Not with this game, but I will probably in the future.
Really?
It's not necessary for this game. I like it to do it with games where you use the cards a lot. If you have to, like with the Star Trek, Star Wars LGC game, I sleeve the cards just because it's easier to handle them, to mix them, and so on.
Okay, because I also play the LOTR LCG, and I don't sleeve the cards, and I think they, I mean, you do notice a bit
Yeah.
wear and tear, but it's not really a problem. But also this might be a different issue because the LOTR LCG is just single player or
Yeah,
co-op
and
against
yeah.
a fixed encounter deck, and for the other LCGs you actually play against a human player, and you could, if the cards are marked, you can see it in the deck and see which card is which. So this might be actually a bit more of a problem, but for Imperial Assault, I don't see myself sleeving the cards anytime soon, especially because there are so many.
Yeah. Yeah, it gets really expensive getting all the cards sleeved, yeah.
And there must be like over there maybe over 200 cards in
I
this
think
game.
at the back of
So
the
it's
Fantasy Flight box they have this color and number code on it. It says how many numbers of which color of their sleeved packs you have to buy to sleeve everything.
It only says 2 and
Yeah,
5.
exactly. You have to need then two of the packs of the green one
Green.
and
Oh,
five,
two green ones and five of
and
the
yellow
yellow
it's
ones.
I think
Okay.
the small cards.
Okay, yeah. Yeah,
And
makes
there are
sense.
some other you don't have to buy the Fantasy Flight ones because they're a little bit more expensive,
Expensive.
but there are other companies that produce cards in the same size. I think I just have encountered
Yeah.
like one or two games where it was almost impossible to find the right size of sleeves. With Summoner Wars, it was really almost impossible to find cards which really fit the Summoner Wars cards because they have such a weird format.
Okay, so no sleeving for me to until now, and probably in the future. And
Yeah, there are always stories for Descent. It's like for the hero sheets. There's like one guy in Thailand or somewhere, he makes like, they have like the order sleeves for the hero cards there. He makes like these big sleeves. And there
okay,
are like
yeah.
people ordering them thanks to Board Game Geek. They are from Thailand because they want to have their hero cards sleeved.
Did the hero cards in Descent also flip over when they are wounded?
Yeah, now when you use the special skill, you flipped over. If you
But
have
there was a
once every character
backside.
has, yeah,
Okay.
every character has one skill he can use once, a sesh, one once an encounter.
Yeah, and then he
And if
slipped
he
over.
used
Yes.
his,
Okay.
so and he has exhausted his special skill.
So the sleeves are transparent on both sides.
Yeah,
Okay.
And they're big enough to fit in a hero card, and I. Hero sheet. I don't remember if the Descent and the Star Wars are the same size. I never actually looked if they were. Huh. I don't know. I'll look it up.
Yeah, probably similar.
Yeah.
Okay. That's
Okay.
it for community stuff. And I think since we already talked for almost 2 hours, we will skip the technological superiority until next time. Also the four skirmish cards, we can save them for next time. We already have time. And so the one thing I wanted to talk about before the lore question is rules clarification. And there was a bit of a Board Game Geek thread about attribute tests, and especially when they are noted in the campaign manual, you have usually, if the attribute test requires more than one success, you have a number, and then you have one or more, mostly one or two attributes besides it. And this works. Some people weren't understanding that this actually means that you need successes from any combination of these two attribute tests. So if you do like you can open a door with either an engineering check or a strength check, and you need three successes for this, you can first do an engineering check, and if you have like one or two successes and then do a strength check, you just add these up, the successes overall. And if you reach three at any time, you succeeded at this attribute test. So you don't need
But it
to.
has to be during your activation. You can't like
No,
have
you
two in
also
this
can. Oh
round
yeah,
and then in.
also you can save it for next round. So even if you just do one attribute test and you fail to reach the like three successes and you wait one round, and in the next round you do another attribute test and roll like two successes, you are at four, and then you can open the door. It's basically a safe mechanic for the successes. Each success you roll, regardless of the attribute, basically saves and makes your subsequent tests easier. It's not easier actually, because you still need to roll the successes, but you need to roll less successes than before. And also the one thing that was cleared up is that if you have the number and then two attributes, the number is the number of successes you need in total. And it's not that you need two strength and one engineering. If there is two, then the strength icon and then the engineering icon. But you need either two engineering or two strength, or a combination of both. So this is rules clarification for the day. I will also link the Board Game Geek thread, because there was a little bit of a discussion because of this, and I think Pazzi made the clear call on this, and he didn't cite the rules in the RG rules reference guide, but someone other did. So it's all in there. So if you're still confused about the attribute tests, look at the thread and you will basically see what's up. So the last thing for today is we still need to draw the winner for last week's law question of the week, and we will of course give you the new question. But first we will need to draw the winner of last week, and we had 14 right answers. This is a new high point for us, I think. And I will of course like always go to random.org and let the number generator there create a number between 1 and 14, and we will see what it is. It's the number 9. Where is my sheet? 8, 9. Okay, we have our winner, and this time the winner is Chris. And Chris actually sent me with his answer, he sent me a fun fact, and he sent the fact that the civilian, of course, the answer to last week's question was the T-16 Skyhopper. It's a light speeder, I think. And the civilian version of this craft apparently includes a laser-targeted autocannon. And he was not really sure how a transorbital high-speed craft with a huge honking gun qualifies as a civilian a civilian craft, because you can go to orbit with it and blast ships, so why is it civilian again? But of course, doesn't matter. Chris, you won,
Well,
and
it's the outer rim. It's
it's the other rim, of course. You need to defend yourself. So, Chris, you won a Chewbacca ally pack, and I will contact you about where to send it and all that stuff. So, for the new question, we actually created a new email address just for the raffle and for winning stuff, because it was getting complicated to actually separate the answers of the contests from other stuff we received via email. So the question first, and the question is this time, what event prompted the life debt of Chewbacca to Han Solo? So we all know that Chewbacca has a life debt with Han Solo, but few people actually know how this came to be. And if you know what's the story behind this, Just write a few sentences about it and send us the email to win@boardwars.eu. This is just win@boardwars.eu. And I will make a call here and say your submission can only be entered into the contest if you really sent the mail to the email I gave you just now, because it's getting really complicated with all the emails otherwise. And of course, next time, if you want to prepare for next time and the episode after that, we will also have a contest, but it won't be a lore question. So if you fancy yourself a game designer, maybe the next contest will be much more in your alley. Okay, this is it. Chris, congratulations on winning your Chewbacca ally pack. And next time, what you can win next time, you can see on the blog within the next few days. And this is it for today. Herwig, any last words?
I'm fine.
Because it's getting already late here. It's
Yeah.
half past 10.
We didn't want to talk that long this time, but again, we managed to
It's just over two
talk for 2 hours.
hours. Yeah, but that's okay. So that's it for this week. And of course, you can reach us on Facebook, which I will link in the show notes. You can reach us on the homepage, which I will also link on the show notes. But if you're not on the homepage, you should already know where the homepage is. Whatever.
Also, we started a Board Game Geek Guild,
Yeah, of
so.
course. I will also link the newly created Board Game Geek Guild, which you can join, which we will probably use for some other stuff on Board Game Geeks. Maybe some play events or something. And of course, you can always reach us via email at podcast@boardwars.eu. So that's it for me. And we'll see you guys again in 2 weeks, I think. Bye.
Bye.